Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 19th of April 2021, and these lectures are basically entirely based on the current affairs. And you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for these lectures. These lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. And I hope you are also studying the national newspapers like The Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can subscribe our channel also for your better preparation. All right, so let's begin with the lecture, which is based on the daily current affairs. Okay, so first is basically related to the disc-footed bat. So bat is one type of a species, which is also a mammal. Okay, so in the Meghalaya, which is a northeastern state, have found a one unique species, which is the bat-footed or the disc-footed bat species. Now, this is a unique species of the bat, which is basically normally resides in the bamboo thickets. That means it is a bamboo-dwelling bat species, which is also having the disc-footed, the bat. Now, it is basically found in the bamboo thickets, specifically in the sticky disc. And it is also one type of mammal, which can also fly. So it is a flying mammal, which are found in our country. If you count this disc-footed flying mammal, right, with other mammals which can fly, the number of such flying mammals in our country rose to 130. Okay, so the scientific name of this disc-footed bat is the Idioscopus denticulus, right, which is a scientific name. Now it is found in the northeastern state of Meghalaya, specifically in the Leilad area near Nongleim Wildlife Sanctuary, right, which is basically around 1000 west of the nearest known habitat in the Myanmar. Okay, but it is found specifically in the Meghalaya state. Now, Meghalaya, as you know, the Meghalaya is basically a state in the northeastern India. Okay, and the Meghalaya is basically carved out, or it is formed, right, by carving out the two districts from Assam, right? The Assam is basically the neighboring state of the Meghalaya. So the Meghalaya, which was carved out, which was formed after carving out the two districts from the neighboring Assam. The first is basically the United Khasi Hills, and the second is basically Jaintia Hills, and basically the remaining part, that is called Garo. So you have the Garo, Khasi, and the Jaintia Hills, which are predominantly are found in the Meghalaya state. Okay, now it has been formed, or it has been carved out, on 21st of January 1972. Regarding this Nongleim Wildlife Sanctuary, this Nongleim Wildlife Sanctuary is basically are found in the Meghalaya state. It is basically found in the Ribhoi district. The Ribhoi is basically a district in Meghalaya, right? So this Nongleim Wildlife Sanctuary is found in the Ribhoi district of Meghalaya. Now it has one of the best protected areas in the northeastern state. Okay, now there are a couple of other bamboo dwelling bats which are found in the Meghalaya, but the unique adoption or unique adaptation that is been found specifically with the disc-footed bat, which have been recently been discovered, is not seen in other areas in India also, right? It has certain unique adaptation features, like you have flattened skull, you have sticky pads, which basically enable the bats to root inside the cramped spaces, which are basically found in the thickets of the bamboo. Okay, and they can also cling to the smooth surfaces such as bamboo internodes, which will basically allow them to adapt in the certain unique features or certain unique adaptation features, as well as they have the ability to hide behind those bamboo thickets. Okay, and these disc-footed bats are also found basically in the genetically very different, which are not with other species, which are also found in the among the bamboos, but have some sort of a different genetical varieties, right, which are also unique in that sense. Okay, now the scientists basically analyze this type of species with respect to other species which are also found in those bamboo living areas. Now, which is basically uniquely have been found inside this bamboo groups. Now, this have been if you count this the disc-footed the bat species, the number of disputed bat that has raised in the Meghalaya's bat count to 66. That means there are 66 type of bat which are found in the Meghalaya state. Okay, that is the highest in any state in India. So maximum number of the bat species, right, which are found in the Meghalaya state, that is 66, and the one of the unique species, that is the disc-footed bat, which is also found in the Meghalaya, which can reside in the thickets of the bamboo. Now, it is also helped to add the genus and specific type of species, specifically in the bat fauna of India. Fauna means the type of animal species which are also unique in that sense. Okay, so it will definitely help in the increasing of the biodiversity of the region. Okay, next you have the Jan Anushasan Pakhwara. Now you must understand, as because of the second wave of coronavirus have going on throughout the country, which has increased the number of cases in the country and which has also increased the number of the deaths in the country. Now the Rajasthan government has come out with a unique pakwara, which is known as Jan Anushasan Pakhwara. Jan Anushasan means it is a public discipline pakwara, right? It is a public discipline program. Now this public discipline fortnight program, which have been announced by the government, is basically to make the public in a disciplined way, right? Specifically during the number of cases which is basically rising in the Rajasthan state. So this decision have come up, right, and which have taken by the Chief Minister of Rajasthan, Mr. Ashok Gehlot, after the state has crossed 10,000 new cases in the state, first time since the COVID-19 pandemic had become in the country. Now this Jan Anushasan Pakhwara is basically an extension of the curfew of in the Rajasthan. Now you must understand, this curfew which is being imposed now, it has not used as a lockdown or some other type of curfew, because it is significantly different, because now you have certain activities now you have allowed, right? For example, you can travel, right? The airports are open, the bus stations are open, right? Your railway stops are open, right? Lot of other activities are also open. So it is definitely a different than the normal lockdown that was imposed last year. Okay, now it is because of the interpretation that we use for that purpose, we have that type of name. Now it is simply an extension of the curfew which Rajasthan government has already announced, right, from April 16 to April 19, right, which is basically from 6 p.m. to 5 p.m., that type of curfew which was imposed by the Rajasthan government. Okay, so you can see here the empty roads where because of the curfew have been imposed by Rajasthani government, right? Okay, next, the International Day for Monuments and the Sites. Now this International Day for the Monuments and the Sites, this is basically every year the United Nations celebrate this International Day for Monuments and the Site on every year on April 18th. Now why it is celebrated? It is celebrated also as a World Heritage Day, right? Obviously, the purpose of celebrating the International Day for Monuments and the Site or the World Heritage Day is to safeguard the world heritage, is to safeguard the heritage of our, of our generations, of our culture, right? So the theme for this year of the International Day for the Monuments is Complex Past and Diverse Future. Now, this International Day for the Monuments is basically promoted by the International Council on the Monuments and the Sites, which is also in short known as ICOMOS. Now, this ICOMOS or International Council on the Monuments and the Site, which promoting this International Day for Monuments and the Sites, is basically a non-governmental international organization. This non-governmental international organization dedicated to the conservation of the world monuments and the sites. Okay, so you can say that the ICOMOS is a professional association. This is an international non-governmental organization that works for the conservation and the protection of the cultural heritage places which are found across the world, right, including India. Okay, and ICOMOS in 1982 has decided to celebrate April 18 as a World Heritage Day or the International Day for Monuments and the Sites. Okay, now This is basically approved by the UNESCO in 1983, once it has been decided by ICOMOS. Okay. And it was basically approved by the UNESCO in its 22nd General Conference. Okay. The day is basically dedicated for definitely for increasing the awareness regarding the historic monuments, right? Those sites which are, you know, having certain set of heritage with us. Now, to raise the awareness, to raise the historic importance, right? To stress the need to restore them, to preserve them, to conserve them. Right. So that is basically approved by the UNESCO. Now, what is this UNESCO? So UNESCO is basically a short form for the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization. So UNESCO is United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization. It is a basically an specialized agency of, you know, of United Nations. Okay. It is a specialized agency of United Nations. The main purpose of this UNESCO, right, is promoting the world peace and the security through international cooperation in education, in the sciences, and in the culture. Okay, so this is basically, or you have all sort of monuments which are symbolic to be preserved and conserved. Okay, next, the on-tap licensing of universal banks and small finance banks in the private sector. Now you must understand there are certain banks which are basically identified by the Reserve Bank of India, right, for the purpose of making them a universal bank, right, to set up a, to give them, you know, a facility of on tap licenses, right, to set up ultimately a universal banks and a small finance bank, right. So 8 such institutions and individuals have applied for on tap licenses, right, to set up these universal banks and small finance banks. The Reserve Bank have recently been announced. Now, what is that one tap or what is that on tap license? So first of all, you must understand, as per the RBI, the licensing window for that purpose of on tap licenses, the licensing window will be open on tap. What does that mean? The licensing window will be open on tap. That means the applications in the prescribed form, along with the requisite information, you could submit directly to the Reserve Bank at any point of the time, right? That is on, you know, that is basically on tap. Now, the applications will be referred to the Standing External Advisory Committee, right, which is basically set up by the Reserve Bank of India for further scrutiny. Now, this Standing External Advisory Committee will submit its recommendation back to the Reserve Bank of India for the consideration. Now, this is what is the internal mechanism for purpose of setting up of this universal bank and small finance banks. Now, this all it comes weeks after the RBI has set up this advisory panel, which is being set up by the former, which is being headed by the former Deputy Governor Shyamala Gopinath, right, to evaluate the applications for the universal and small finance banks, right, which is mandated to focus on the priority sector lending, right, as well as for the smaller loans to the unorganized sector. So specifically for the priority sector lending, this advisory panel, which was set up by the RBI and which was led by the former deputy governor, Mr. Shyamala Gopinath. Okay. Now you must understand, last time when RBI basically used this type of universal banking license, that was in 2015, right? At that point of the time, it cleared the IDFC banks, the IDFC Bank Limited, as well as the Bandhan's financial applications. Now, in 2016, the RBI released the guidelines for on-tap licensing for the universal banks. Now, one thing that will be coming to your mind, what is that universal bank? What is that universal banking? So let's understand what is that, first of all, the universal banking. What is universal banking? So universal banking means a financial entities, right? That may be a commercial bank, that may be a financial institutions, that may be in the non-banking financial companies, the NBFCs, that undertake the multiple financial activities under one roof, right? Thereby, these entities create a financial supermarket because they used to do the multiple financial activities under one roof, and thereby creating a financial supermarket. So these entities mainly focusing on leveraging their large branch markets. So they have larger branch markets and offer the wide range of services under single brand name, right? That is called universal banking. So now the universal bank, what is that universal bank? So you can say in the simply term, the universal bank is a bank that combines the three main services. That is, you know, the three main services of the banking under one roof. What is that? The three main services are, first of all, the wholesale banking, second, retail banking, and the third, investment banking. So wholesale banking, retail banking, and investment banking, if that is provided under one roof, that is called the universal bank. In other words, what you can say that it is a retail bank, it is a wholesale bank, and it is also an investment bank, because all such facilities are being provided by the universal bank. Now, these banks are also able to offer you, right? You can also understand these banks are also able to offer you and, you know, all encompassing services, right? So they can basically operate in all three services simultaneously. And logically, such banks offer universal banking, right? So it's a typical type of financing services that combine all aspects of investment, retail, or wholesale banking. And they also offer the financial services like insurance also to you. So such type of banking or such type of banks are called universal banks. Okay. Now, the RBI has made certain eligibility for such promoters of these banks. So among the eligibility regarding those promoters, so first of all, they should be resident professionals who have 10 years of experience in the banking and the finance at the senior level, right? They should only be applied for that purpose, or if they belong to the private sector entities and they owned and controlled by the residents and have the successful track record of running such business for at least 10 years, right? They are eligible. Okay. Provided they have an asset of around 5 crore or more, right? This is what is eligibility criteria, and their non-financial business group does not account for 40% or more of total assets or the gross income. That is eligibility criteria that has been set by the Reserve Bank of India. And existing non-banking financial companies which are controlled by the residents, they can also apply for such type of, you know, universal banks, but they also must have the successful track record of at least 10 years before being applying for such license. Okay. Next, the Hot Spring and Gogra post. Now, these are the two posts which are basically still controlled by the China. They are still controlled by the China. That means they are still there. The Chinese troops are still there at that two points. They are called Hot Spring, or they are also called Gogra posts. They are the two posts. Now, as you know that Indo-China talks are going on, 11th round of discussions between India and the China, between the senior military officials or senior military commanders are underway, right, on April 9th to resolve the 11-month long standoff or the deadlock in the Eastern Ladakh between India and the China. But even after this 11th round of discussion, the China has refused to vacate the two of the four original friction points, right? These friction points are those points where the original conflict was started. These two frictional points are, first is basically the Hot Springs, and second is basically Gogra Post. So these two friction points, which are also known as the patrolling point 15, or which are also known as PP15 in the Hot Springs, and the second is the patrolling point 17A, which is near the Gogra Post. China have still, you know, its platoon labor strength at that, the PP15 and PP17A, along with it has lot of the vehicles also. Okay. And you must understand that along the line of actual control, which basically divides India and the China, right? Now, there are certain locations where, you know, the Indian Army as well as the China has, you know, the access to patrol, right, under the area which they control, right? So what is this line of actual control? So line of actual control is basically a notional demarcation. It is a notional demarcation line that separates the Indian control territory from Chinese controlled territory in the Sino-Indian border dispute. Now, this term, the line of actual control, is said to have said to be used by Zhou and Lai, by Zhou and Lai, who was basically a premier of China in 1959. Right? It was written by the Zhou Lai in a letter to the on that time the Prime Minister of India, that was Jawaharlal Nehru. Right? So that term was basically used. Now, these points, which are basically a friction points, are also sometimes also known as patrolling points. Right? They are decided by the China study group. Now, these two friction points, PP15 and PP17A, are basically the two of the 65 patrolling points, which are located in the Ladakh along the line of actual control. Now, if you see this PP15 or patrolling point 15 is basically located in the area which is also known as the hot spring, and PP17A, which is located in the area which is also known as the Gogra post, Okay, now both of these are close to the Chenmo River. This Chenmo River basically, which is flows through the Galwan subsector of the line of actual control in the eastern Ladakh. Now, what is that Chenmo River? Why the China is most concerned about this Chenmo River? See, this Chenmo River, which is also known as the Chenmo River, is a tributary of Shayok River. It is a tributary of Shayok River, which is also flows through the Jammu and Kashmir. Now, it is a part of Indus River system, first of all. Okay, now, it is at the southern edge of the disputed Aksai Chin region. As you know, that disputed Aksai Chin is an Indian territory which have been have been taken by the China, right? Since it have been given by the Pakistan to the China. So it is basically at the southern edge of the disputed Aksai Chin territory or Aksai Chin region, as well as to the north of the Pangong Lake Basin. Now, the source of this Changchenmo River is basically near the Lanak Pass. The Lanak Pass is located in the Chinese administered region of Kashmir. Now, that is the problem. That is the problem that the China is most concerned about this Changchenmo River, because first of all, it passes through to the southern edge of disputed Aksai Chin, as well as the source of this Changchenmo River is near the Lanak Pass, and which is also in the Chinese administered region of Kashmir. And that is the reason the China is concerned about this PP15 and PP17A, which is lying to the shores of this Changchenmo River. Now, this is basically in the Galwan subsector. Now, there is also one river called Galwan River. What is that Galwan River? Now, this Galwan River also flows through this disputed region, which is also known as Aksai Chin region. Now, this Aksai Chin region is currently being administered by the China, as you all know, right? So this is basically, you know, one of the bone of contention between the India and the China. All right. Now, these hot springs is just north to the Changchenmo River, right? Which is also the PP15, which is also the PP15. Now, that is the reason that it lies to the north of Changchenmo River. The Gogra post, which is lying to the east of this point, that is PP17A, right? Which is also the bone of contention. Now, where the river, the Changchenmo River, takes a hairpin bend and coming to the southeast from the Galwan Valley, and ultimately it turns to the southwestern region. So you can see the atlas of the Jammu and Kashmir region, that you can easily find out this Changchenmo River, which is a tributary of, basically your Shayok River, which is a part of your Indus River system. Now, the area to the north of Karakoram range of the mountains, which lies to the north of Pangong Taso Lake, and it also lies to the southeast of Galwan Valley, which is also the most important strategic region. Here you can see, the Indian military trucks, which is being passing out through the Indian region. Okay, next, you have the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant. Now, there was an earthquake in 2011, specifically in March 2011, right? This earthquake has the magnitude of 9, right? Which basically occurred in the Japan, specifically in the Fukushima prefecture in the Japan. Now, what happens is, because of this 9 magnitude earthquake, the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant was basically badly damaged. It was severely damaged. Now, what happens is, because of the damage, now this plant is unable to restart back because it has caused the severe damage to many of the reactors. Now, it has, the million tons of the water, which is basically also, the nuclear waste water. Now, obviously, you must understand that the nuclear waste water will have, some of the radioactive elements in the water. Now, if you release directly this water, right, it may impact, right, the, obviously, the aquatic life, right, in the oceans, if you're releasing in the ocean. If you release in the water bodies, obviously the water bodies will get impacted, and ultimately the humans will also get impacted. And now what will happen? That obviously you have to treat that water. So the Japan has decided to release the 1 million tons of the treated water that is basically coming out of the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant directly into the Pacific Ocean. In the Pacific Ocean, in the in the Japan. Now, what has happened? That China is basically concerned about releasing of this treated water from Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant, and it has asked the Japan, right, to take back its decision not to release this 1 million tons of water specifically in the Pacific Ocean. So that was the case. Now, obviously, this Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant that was disabled, right, because of earthquake that was happened. This Fukushima Daiichi nuclear plant is located in the Fukushima prefecture in the Japan, and that is damaged because of an earthquake that is a magnitude of 9 earthquake that occurs on March 11, 2011, right? So after that, a chain of event that caused the radiation leaks, and that is permanently damaging the several reactors, right? This damaged reactors was almost impossible to start. Now, the government has finally decided to not to restart them and rather to dismantle them, right? And government basically approved in April 2021 to dump this radioactive water into Pacific Ocean, but it will be dumped over the course of 30 years so that no untoward or no adverse impact on the aquatic life will be taken place in specifically in the Pacific region. But the China, which is basically one of the notorious countries, which is basically causing so much uneasiness to almost every country, is causing again a problem here, is asking the Japan, which is one of the superior countries in terms of decision making, right, to take back this decision. All right. So here you can see the Fukushima, where the Fukushima prefecture, where such type of magnitude earthquake was occurred. Okay, next you have the Ramanujacharya. Okay, now the Ramanujacharya was basically a great philosopher. He was a great saint. He was a social reformer also. Now the vice president, Mr. M. Venkaiya Naidu, paid the tribute to the great social reformer Sri Ramanujacharya on its birth anniversary or its Jayanti. Now, the Ramanujacharya was born in 1017 circa, that is CE, right? And he died basically in 1000, he basically born in, 1137 CE, and he basically died in 1017 CE, right? He was basically a Hindu theologian. He was a philosopher, social reformer, and most important, he was basically an exponent of the Sri Vaishnavism tradition within the Hinduism, right? Now, he has some sort of a philosophical foundation, right? That is for the devotionalism, which influenced the Bhakti movement in our country, right? Now, the Ramanuja Guru, who was also the Yadava Prakasha, who was basically a scholar, now was a part of the most ancient Advaita Vedanta monastic tradition. Now, what is that Advaita Vedanta? Now, you must understand the Advaita Vedanta is a school of Hindu philosophy, right? And it's a classic system of spiritual realization in the Indian tradition. Now, the term that you are referring here, Advaita, is basically refers to the idea referred to the idea that the Brahmin alone is the ultimate reality, and the phenomenal transient world is just an illusionary appearance of the Brahmin. You're getting my point. The Brahmin alone is the ultimate reality, and the true self or the Atman is not different from the Brahmin. That is as per the Advaita, you know, Vedantic monastic tradition. Now, Sri Vaishnava tradition, which hold that the Ramanuja disagreed with his guru, right, as well as with the non-dualistic Advaita Vedanta. And instead, right, the Ramanuja followed in the footsteps of the Tamil Alvars tradition, which was also, you know, some of the scholars like the Nathamuni or Yamunacharya. Now, the Ramanuja, which was also famous for the chief proponent of the Visist Veda, right? Visist Veda sub school of Vedanta, right? And he also and his disciples also likely to be authored many texts, such as Satyaniya Upanishad. Now, what is that Visist Advaita? The Visist Advaita, you can say that the Advaita with uniqueness. Visist. Visist means a uniqueness. So the Advaita with uniqueness. Just now I have explained you Advaita. Just now I have explained you. Okay. So Advaita with a uniqueness or a unique qualifications. It's a non-dualistic school of Vedanta philosophy. It's a non-dualistic school of Vedanta philosophy. Right? It is a non-dualism of qualified whole in which the Brahmin alone exists, right? But it is characterized by multiplicity. You're getting my point. The Brahmin alone exists, but it is characterized by this multiplicity, and it can be described as a qualified monism or the qualified non-dualism, or you can also say that the attributive monism, right? Which is also the one of the important aspect of the Visist Veda sub-school of Vedanta. Okay, now the Ramanuja himself wrote the influential texts such as the Bhashya, which is basically, you know, on the Brahma Sutras, as well as the Bhagavad Gita, all in Sanskrit, right? And his Visist Veda, which is qualified non-dualism, just now I have explained you, is a philosophy that has competed with the Dvaita, that is the theistic dualistic philosophy. Now, right, of the Madhvacharya as well as the Advaita, which is basically a non-dualism philosophy. I have just explained you the difference between the two. Now, let me explain again the difference between the Advaita as well as the you know, your you know, the Dvaita philosophy. What is the difference between Advaita and Dvaita philosophy? So first of all, let me clear you Advaita. See, Advaita propound that the world is an illusion. The Advaita or non-dualism philosophy of Adi Shankaracharya, what it does signify? The Advaita propound that the world is just an illusion. Whatever the action or all action and emotions, including the sorrow that we have, is just a false impressions, because it first take the presumption that the world is an illusion. Whatever emotions and action you take, that are just in false impressions. Fundamentally, according to the Advaita, right, the soul and the God are the one. The soul and the God are one. And when the soul releases itself from the illusion, that is from the fundamental human nature, it merges with the Brahmin. So whenever the soul releases, it ultimately merges with the Brahmin. And that is that in the Advaita philosophy, that is called universal consciousness. That is called universal consciousness. What is in the Dvaita, or what is that theistic dualism? In the Dvaita, the Dvaita philosophy, the propounder think that the world is real. You're getting my point. What is Advaita? In the Advaita, the propounder think that the world is an illusion. But what is in Dvaita? In the Dvaita, the propounder or the philosopher think that the world is real. The world is real. God, which is the creator of this world, is also real. And there is a natural difference between ordinary and ignorant soul, right? Who experience the sorrow in this world, right? And the God who knows all is basically an omnipresent, or who is basically the omnipotent, which is basically found everywhere. So it is an essence of the Dvaita Siddhanta, right? So if this concept of Dvaita that we learn is relevant even in the today's world. Even in the today's world, the Sri Madhvacharya says that the world is real, and very thought that is helping the preserving of the escapism or motivates one to perform the duty sincerely. right? So this Dwaita philosophy motivates the person to perform its duties sincerely, and it also establishes the supremacy of God. And it also indicates the followers a path to the devotion. And it also cautions us about his omnipresence of the God. Thus, this Dwaita or this Dwaita or theistic dualism also stress the importance of the righteousness. That is the most important difference between the Dwaita and Advaita philosophy, which was also most important. Okay, so he is basically the Ramanuja, the person who is basically one of the important saint which was known. Okay, next, the pressure swing adsorption oxygen plants. Now you must understand, because of this coronavirus pandemic, there is huge shortage of the oxygen in the various hospitals. Now we need the oxygen cylinders for that purpose. Now the health ministry has said that it is going to have 162 pressure swing adsorption oxygen plants, that is called PSA oxygen plants, right? That is being established and that is being sanctioned by the government of India for installation in public health facilities, and from there directly oxygen cylinders will be filled, and this will definitely augment the oxygen capacity by over 154 metric tons of oxygen. Now you will be thinking, what is that adsorption means? See, adsorption is basically an adhesion of atoms or ions or molecules from the gas. You're getting my point? So simply it's an adhesion of atoms, ions or molecules from the gas or from the liquid or from the dissolved solid to the surface. Okay, now this process of adhesion create a film of the adsorbate on the surface of adsorbent. Okay, now this process that is different from absorption, it is not absorption but it is a adsorption, because adsorption is basically is the surface process that leads to the transfer of molecule from one fluid bulk to the solid surface, right, where the adsorption is taking place. And this can occur because of the physical forces or because of this chemical bonds, and usually the adsorption process is reversible also. So this pressure swing adsorption is basically a technology that is basically used for the purpose of oxygen. Now what it does, just now I have explained you the adsorption, so it separates the gas species from the mixture of gases, right? And that is under high pressure, right? So that is under pressure according to the species molecular characteristics, right? That is basically affinity for an adsorption material that is basically used for the purpose of adsorption. Okay, now it is basically operates in the near ambient temperature, right? And it differs significantly from cryogenic distillation techniques that is basically used for the gas separation. Now the various adsorbents are used, right? It is based on the property of the gas that is you are basically used, going to produce. So such type of adsorbent materials like zeolites, activated carbon, the molecular sieves which are also used, right, which used to trap and preferably adsorbing the target gas, that may be your oxygen. So here the process basically where the target gas is basically captured at the high pressure, and then the process is then swing to the low pressure to dissolve this absorbed material and ultimately produce the oxygen at that process. So this is basically the pressure swing adsorption oxygen plant that will be established in the healthcare facilities. Okay, next, the COVID-19 vaccines and the blood clots. Now what is happening is that the AstraZeneca, which is a vaccine, now you must understand this vaccine has certain side effects, like it is causing the blood clots. It is causing the blood clots specifically in the large vessels. Now that is basically a huge concern for the medical, to the medical fraternity as well as for the persons who are taking this vaccine. So the rare blood clots have been reported right after the COVID-19 vaccination. Now, so that is basically forced many countries to limit the uses of AstraZeneca vaccine, because that is, it is producing the blood clots, right, in certain categories of the people. And other countries also paused this vaccination of this AstraZeneca vaccine, right, in their countries. Now, obviously, if it is producing the blood clots in the large vessel, right, and definitely it is also reducing the platelet count. It is reducing the platelet count. Now, this phenomena of reducing this platelet count as well as causing the blood clot is similar phenomena that happens with the heparin induced the thrombocytopenia, which is also known as HIT. This phenomena also has, you know, caused the, you know, the blood clots, right, as well as it is also responsible for the falling of the platelet count also. Now this heparin combines with a platelet factor 4 to form this complex. Now this complex, which is formed, right, this is called immune complex, induces the abnormal immune response in the patients. Now, in which the antibodies are generated against the complex. Okay. And this antibody platelet, which is a factor of 4 heparin immune complex, bind to the platelets. Now, what happens is these platelets started binding up with that, and that will basically activate them. So what will happen? These platelets ultimately form the clots everywhere. Now, once the platelets are basically used in formation of the clots or the blood clots, what will happen? That will responsible for the low platelet count, because such clots that are formed out of the platelets only, because the platelets are used for the formation of these clots. The similar process seems to follow in the vaccination also, right? Obviously, we have no such heparin trigger. So scientists are basically trying to find out what is the clinical definition for such phenomena or such adverse effect of having this AstraZeneca vaccine and causing this blood clots and also reduction with you know, number of platelet counts in those, you know, the people who take this vaccine. So it is under clinical study, right, which is also a most important significant part of the study also. Okay, next you have occultation. What is occultation? See, occultation is a phenomena when it's a, basically you can say it's a celestial event where one object is hidden by another object, right? Or you can say that when something comes between observer and the real, you know, an object. So that is called occultation. So simple, you know, the sky gazers basically watch the rare celestial event, that is when the moon came between Earth and the Mars. So moon has covered the Mars. So that is the, you know, sky gazers are unable to see the Mars. That is phenomena that is called occultation. So moon was there in between Earth and the Mars. Okay. So it's a simple event. It's a celestial event when an object is hidden by another object. So here the moon has hidden the Mars, and that is unable to see, you know, the observers from the Earth. And that is basically the term that occultation, right? Occultation that is basically used in the astronomy. Okay. Now you can see that if a closer body does not entirely conceal, you know, the body, you can say that with not entirely covered, that event is called transit. That event simply called a transit. Now, both the transit as well as the occultation, right? Both are generally referred to as occlusion, right? But you must understand, if the shadow is cast on the observer, that is called eclipse, right? For example, you have the solar eclipse, when the shadow is cast on the observer, right? So here the occultation is done by the moon, right? And this occultation is basically most frequently used to describe these relatively frequent occasions when the moon passes in front of the star. That is here, right, during the course of its orbital motion around the Earth, because the moon basically, you know, revolve around the Earth, nothing but, right? So during its passes, it basically comes in front of the star, and definitely during the passes of or during this motion, orbital motion around the Earth. All right, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our current